This is the Detroit Sports Podcast Network.
Doc here for DetroitBeardCollective.com, Detroit's premier grooming company. Visit DetroitBeardCollective.com for quality beard care products. Detroit Beard Collective is a Michigan-based company that takes pride in providing quality and affordable products for men to care for their beards. Jock uses the beard soaps when his rec league hockey team is growing out their beards. If you're rocking a beard this winter, you definitely need to check out the Beard Butter Leave-In Conditioning Beard Balm. Beard Butter will make your beard feel softer, better smelling than ever before. Go visit DetroitBeardCollective.com and at checkout, use the promo code DSP for 15% off savings. That's DetroitBeardCollective.com, promo code DSP. I want to tell you about our newest sponsor, Team Top Cat Sales. Are you looking for team apparel for your high school, your club sports team, or corporation? Look no further than Top Cat Sales, located on the east side of Main Street in downtown Royal Oak, between 11 and 12 Mile. Through founder and former University of Michigan QB John Wangler's leadership, Top Cat Sales has developed a tradition of selling and distributing custom Adidas team apparel with the highest quality and best service. Get your organization, school, or club team all in with Adidas today by going to TopCatTeamSales.com. That's TopCatTeamSales.com. Also, follow Top Cat on Twitter at Team Top Cat.
Hey, everybody, this is Freddie Cohen of ESPN Radio. When I'm not talking about breaking news or breaking news on ESPN Radio, I'm always a fan and listening to the Detroit Sports Podcast, and so should you.
Welcome, everybody. Thank you for hitting that download button on the Detroit Sports Podcast Network. This is the Doc and Jock Sports Program. I am the Doc, John Macaroon. Joining me, my cousin, Adam the Jock Strozinski. Welcome to episode 130, cuz. What's happening?
As we're streaming this, we've got the Michigan, what is this, the Love Fest going on here for signing day? This is unbelievable. They anybody who has any affiliation, if you ever wore a Block M hat, you are on this thing right now. They just had Jalen Rose up there. I love Jalen. But before that, they had Chad Henning up there, who was great for 4 years. Then he went to the pros, and now he's a complete disaster. Owen Wilson. Like, anybody and everybody who had any sort of an affiliation with the university is on this thing. And there's a lot of production into this, dude. Like, they got the really nice seats out there that are big, thick, and leather-bound. You got Jim and John Harbaugh sitting there. Ric Flair was there wooing it up. This is insane.
What are your thoughts? Do you think Michigan and Jim Harbaugh have to pump their chest out like this and really put it out there? Because compared to Michigan State, I don't feel like there's going to be so much pomp and circumstance. But as watching it, I tuned it in 11:30 before we started recording. I was like, okay, let's see what this is all about. They really have made it a productive, very entertaining show. And I'm sitting here like, wow, dude, this is pretty fascinating. I feel like, you know, this is an hour commercial for the University of Michigan football program. They are pulling out all the stops. It's very nice to, you know, see, you know, Todd McShay, Lou Holtz, Mike Shanahan commenting on all these recruits. But some people on our Twitter page at Detroit Podcast have kind of been like, this is how egos develop. This is kind of, you know, bad for the look of Michigan. Michigan's kind of above this, that the name Michigan on its own, the Block M, should just be enough to recruit these people. That Jim Harbaugh is really kind of taking this way over the top, and kind of has Michigan gone Hollywood?
You know what? This is something that I was, when we had the web show with Justin this past Monday, this is something I was trying to work my way around to, but we never quite got to it because the show was just so jam-packed with so much more. I don't like this. I really don't. I feel like it's a lot of what the Twitter followers were saying. It's just, it's kind of overdoing it. I don't see the need for it. It strikes me as being almost arrogant. And this is the one thing that a lot of Michigan fans don't like to be considered. We don't like to be considered arrogant. You know, leaders and best is fine, but you don't have to go around telling everybody that you're the leaders and best. You just say Michigan and they know. It's what it is. And this strikes me as being, I don't know the word for it. I don't think I've ever seen anything like this before in my entire life. I've been around for 32 years, man. This is insane to me. I mean, hey, good for Jim. And if that's going to help you pull recruits, do what you do. But see now, I don't like this.
See now, cuz this is the age-old adage and the debate that people have now. You know, when I grew up, I started watching tennis, and you had Pete Sampras. Classy dude, would just blow you off the court, shake your hand, and leave. Then all along came Andre Agassi with the flash, the possess.
I love Andre Agassi.
See, why? Why did you love Andre Agassi? Because he had personality. He had flair. He would go, you know, he started having great commercials. He had big flair. He had big personality. And he was a guy that brought a lot of people into the sport of tennis because of his personality. Now, in the Super Bowl, you have the dichotomy of the classy, prototypical NFL quarterback in Peyton Manning, and then you got on the other side the flamboyant Cam Newton, who's dancing, doing his thing. And in the Lions, you have the same kind of stuff. You had Barry Sanders, who is just kind of flipped the ball, you know, to the referees, wouldn't do a whole lot of celebrating. Calvin Johnson, same thing, would just go about his business, handle himself, and was professional. Whereas on the other side, you have some athletes, maybe like a Golden Tate, you have an Ebron who liked to, you know, shimmy shake and do all their thing and kind of have a little bit more fun with it. So that's an age-old debate, and I kind of slap back and forth. I do like the celebratory. I like the passion of sports. I like this a little bit, but I'm not a Michigan supporter. I like this because in this day and age, you have to be aware of what do people like. People like flash and pizzazz. What is going to recruit these young athletes? And doing stuff like this, when Jim Harbaugh calls you up and you're like, whoa, I got a call from Harbaugh, and you know you got a lineage of Tom Brady. You got a chance to maybe shake the hand. Some of these recruits were shaking the hand of Tom Brady and Derek Jeter. You get to appreciate the lineage. Now, is it a little bit over the top? Yes. But I think if Michigan wants to be in the big boy dance, you got to do it. So I kind of like it. I kind of wish Michigan State would do it because from all accounts, you're not hearing a whole heck of a lot. You know, Michigan State's getting good recruits, but the pomp and circumstance surrounding the event is not as much as Michigan.
Yeah, I was going to ask you, if this was a Michigan State-sponsored event, would you be all into it?
Oh, I'd love it, dude.
If we got Hulk Hogan, we wouldn't even record, would we? You'd just sit here and you'd watch the whole time.
I'll be like, oh my God, I have to go. If they got Hulk, they should have tried to top it. I mean, I don't understand. This was publicized. People knew about it. Mm-hmm. They should have went out and got John Cena. Just tit for tat. Just, you know what? Not Players Tribune. Go out there and get ESPN. Hell, just go for it. Go for it all. Let them, you know, do whatever they want to do. Mark D'Antonio can come out with the Ric Flair boa to kind of insult them. All that good stuff. I think, you know, Mark D'Antonio is keeping it above board, professional. It's going to be a nice day for Michigan State because they got a lot of good athletes, but Michigan's made it a circus and a show. And I like it. I'm watching it. I'm tuned in. I'm learning about all these athletes, the quarterback coming in, the young stud running backs they got coming in.
All the guys you won't hear about for the next 2 years.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
So I'm impressed. I like what I'm seeing. And if this is the wave of the future, if it's player run, now you got to remember too, the Players Tribune is streaming this, and that's founded by Michigan alum.
That's right, Derek Jeter.
Derek Jeter. So this is another way to spin the message, and you know, you're not going to have too much talk about some of the negatives going on at Michigan with the decommitments and some of the issues going on at Michigan. But hey, I like it. I think it's a nice way to showcase your program. I'm fully on board with it.
The worst part about it all is you have two people who I could care less what you have to say. Like, I seriously, like, who gives two crabs what Mike Shanahan has to say?
At this point, right?
Right. Who cares what Lou Holtz has to say as he spits all over everything? The only person who I really care about is Todd McShay. And at this point, I think Todd McShay takes a little bit of a credibility hit doing something like this. But that all being said, news came out the other day that the Lions are increasing ticket prices. And I know that we've talked about it before. You used to be a longtime ticket holder. You got out during the Millen era. You were smart. You said, I can't handle this anymore. What are your thoughts on the Lions increasing ticket prices? And this is all happening in the wake of possibly Calvin Johnson retiring, the best player on your team possibly walking away. So how do you have the balls and the gall to do something like this?
I love the spin and the way they announced it. Modest ticket price increase. It's over like 12, 13%.
I know. Some people are getting like hit for over $1,000 to increase their ticket prices. That's insane. Yeah.
Okay, so
it's nuts. How is that modest?
I don't understand.
Is this California?
See, the problem is, though, how do they determine the market value? Because people are going to pay it. But 13%, I wouldn't do it. I mean, it's not worth it. I mean, Calvin Johnson's leaving. You have a new regime. What are you going to sell? Matthew Stafford and Golden Tate? Even any of the new players? Unless you go out and make a big splash, 13% increase in ticket prices, I couldn't do it. Because in the end, imagine now if the Lions ever get good. Are the ticket prices going to average $100?
Dude, they'll be like what you have to pay in New England.
I averaged, when I started back in the early 2000s, they were about $48 to $52. And they kept going up. By the time we stopped, they were about $62. And they were 20 rows up in the end zone. Imagine now if you're starting off at $75 and you're going up to $120. you know, not in 1 year, but steadily. If you've been there, you probably started off at around $50. Now you're paying probably double.
And the thing is, it's for 10 games. You're paying for two preseason games. You're getting like garbage product for at least two out of those 10 games, which is atrocious in it in and of itself. But it's just mind-blowing that they have the gall to do this. Because if I recall, they were below 500 last year. They didn't make the playoffs. They started the season atrociously, and there was all this talk about them possibly firing their head coach. And then they turn around, and they want to sell us on, oh, it's just a modest increase.
See, the problem
is you are jacking the price up on some of these tickets by over $1,000.
65,000 tickets. If you lose 5,000-10,000, I feel like you could replace them. That's the problem. The problem is, though, in order to bring the prices down, people have to stop buying them. That's the problem, is that they're sold out. Now the NFL has removed any of the really pressing issue for the Lions. They don't have to sell out because they lifted the blackouts.
Right.
So there's no pressure on that front. So the Lions can say, okay, what number do we think is fair? And they came up with that number. People are going to pay it, though. That's the real problem. If fans in droves just stop renewing and they would not go to the games, then the Lions would scale back the prices. But people are, there's just eight regular season games. There's, you know, a big demand. The NFL can do no wrong. Really, in the end, people are going to pay it. That's the definition of a market price economy, is that they set the price. If people pay it, then it's worth it for them. So the Lions have to do it. But 13%, I saw that number. I'm like, I could never be a Lions season ticket holder again. I couldn't do that. I couldn't take a pay increase. I'd want just the same price, or I just have to move back because, you know, I just would have to sit in the nosebleeds.
Dude, this is such a ballsy organization. To be able to do that,
yeah.
And now couple this with your general manager not calling your best player on your team to see if he wants to stay or retire. It just blows my mind how this organization runs. What are your thoughts on Bob Quinn not even reaching out to Calvin Johnson yet? And this has been going on now. He's come out and he basically said that, hey, this is my last year. He told the coaching staff, he told multiple players that last game when they were in Chicago, like, I'm done after this. The team says, you know what? Take a little time. Think about it. This, that, the other thing. They go out, they hire Bob Quinn. Bob Quinn's now been on the job for, what, 3 weeks or so? Maybe four? More than enough time to just pick up the phone and say, hey, CJ, what's up? What's on your mind? What can we discuss here? And CJ could say, hey, there's nothing that we can talk about. But just for you to have the open lines of communication with a player, you would think that would be there.
Now, here's the tough part for Bob Quinn, is that publicly he has to show support for a top receiver when, professionally speaking, in terms of the salary cap, in terms of the fit for Calvin Johnson on this team, he may not even want him on the team. He may be thinking, okay, I'm ready to move on from him. So we don't know exactly what Bob Quinn is thinking in those meetings.
That's my thought right there.
Yeah. So
if you look at where Bob Quinn comes from, he's from the New England school of thought, right? Receivers are a dime a dozen. You can go pick one up off the street, pull one off a couch, plug him in, and you'll be okay. All that money that we could free up in the salary cap, we can now take that, go spend it on free agents, maybe better up our offensive and defensive line, maybe go out there, get another wide receiver. We can do all sorts of things. I don't need you. I don't necessarily want you. Hurry up, make a decision, so then I can sit there and get to work and get what I need to get done.
Exactly. And so a guy like Bob Quinn doesn't have to go out there. But now, in the last couple of days, since your appearance on the WXYZ.com web show, Mondays at 12:30, since your appearance now, Nate Burleson, who is new to the media, is really getting himself on every platform as possible, at NFL, on Twitter. Dude likes to hear Nate Burleson talk. I know that.
Have you ever watched him on NFL Network?
Yeah, I watch him.
Do you like him or no?
I don't like his swag, like his style, like with the glasses and stuff, his total like presentation, but I like what he says.
His appearance?
I don't like his swag. Yeah, I don't like his attire.
Okay.
He's kind of like too much.
But what about what he has to say?
Yeah, in terms of what he has to say, I like what he has to say.
Yeah, I enjoy him. I think he does a really good job. It's weird when you watch a player make that transition because sometimes they struggle with it.
Oh, there was no difference. No. He was doing that stuff when he was playing.
Exactly.
You knew he was going to do that kind of stuff.
He's very good at what he does. But yeah. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
I say that now, since you appeared on the webcast, Nate Burleson talks to Calvin Johnson, their boys from their playing days. And he's kind of come out and said, hey, until he says something, I wouldn't go ahead and write his eulogy just yet. So now talk is, okay, maybe there is a 10% chance that with calls from Stafford, with calls from Tate, maybe an influence on the team can get him to come back. Now, his wedding date is set for the time OTAs is going to start in early June. It's going to be in Georgia. He's going to get married. So is he going to miss OTAs? I think that Calvin Johnson honestly is deciding. is debating whether or not to come back, with a heavy, heavy dose of not coming back being the favorite. But if there's 10% chance that he comes back, then the question is, should the Lions accept him back? Should they ask him to take a pay cut? Or are they going to say, okay, fine, is if you're going to use this coming and going as a marketing ploy or as a ploy to try to keep the money that's owed to you, then we got to let you go. And my honest opinion is, I would not be pissed. I would not be upset at all if the organization allowed him to come back, or I would not be pissed at all if they said, okay, well, you have to take this pay cut. Boom, you have to be at this number, and if you're not, we'll cut you. I would not be mad either way, because he can be a productive player when healthy. He can, and also he can be in that secondary role that can help, take double teams so Golden Tate and others can be productive. I would not be mad either way. I would lean toward personally saying goodbye, starting over, because this team is not anywhere near a Super Bowl. Just retool this team to get them where they need to be at the Super Bowl level. That's it.
I'm right there on the same page as you. I wouldn't be mad if he came back, but I think I'd be happier if he did leave, because it frees up some money. This team can now reinvest, kind of build this a little bit different. The big hurdle that you're going to have to get over, and that's going to come down the road, is with Matt Stafford. Do you keep Stafford, and how much do you sign him to? And is that palpable? Because you don't want to give a guy like that who's not won a playoff game. He's not really won anything. I know he has a ton of records, and all the Lions fans who love Matt Stafford, they just want to throw like the records that he gets and what he does and how many yards he's passed for. That's great. But what has he won? Those yards come in garbage time. I don't care that he's a top 5 or top 10 passer in the league when he's sitting there in the record 7-9 at the end of the year. Because just because he sat there and annihilated a team in the fourth quarter when they were down by 30 points doesn't mean absolutely anything to me. Because he's not producing wins. He's not a winner in this league. At least he hasn't shown it yet. He's shown that he's a tough guy. He's shown that he has a lot of arm strength. But other than that, he hasn't really shown me anything. So if you sit there, you move down the line, you let Calvin go, you free up some money. You can now turn around, try to figure out what you're going to do with Matt Stafford. I think you rebuild these offensive and defensive lines. I think that's where the focus needs to be going into this offseason. You got to get that offensive line better so you can protect your quarterback, whether it be Matt Stafford or whether it be somebody else down the road. You have to get that defensive line better because it took a major blow last offseason. You lost too much up front. Your most productive member, and he is a stud, and that's Ziggy Ansah. You know, you need to add something with him. Could you imagine if you paired Ziggy Ansah with a guy like Aaron Donald? Woo-hoo. Could you imagine what you would have up front? It would be disgusting. So you need to help him. You need to get him a little bit of help up there. But I think at this point, the way I'm leaning, I think Calvin Johnson is pretty much done. Okay. I want to say 95% he's done.
Okay, we'll take 2 seconds here to just take a little break. We got a little update from the Michigan thing. Mm-hmm. Ric Flair just cut a little promo. And you know what he said? I can't stand Ohio State, and I got no time for Michigan State. They brought Ric Flair to do some PR for Michigan,
and
man.
You love yourself.
I love Ric Flair, but that,
Ric Flair.
The tweets coming across are a little bit of a dagger, but the persona of Ric Flair, I get it. He's there at Michigan. He took a swipe. I get it, but oh, that hurts a little bit.
Are we gonna change Doc's session there?
May have to change it to the New World Order for a minute. but no, I can't help it, dude. The Ric Flair persona, I get it. I get what he did, but ooh, for a Sparty, that was a little dagger. But Ric Flair's the man. Okay, now,
I want to know, Calvin Johnson, has his career been wasted by these Lions?
Yes, 100%. I spoke to Hatchet Man on the One-on-One podcast, which you can find on the network, and he said he's only had to play 2 games more than the norm for his career because they're never in the playoffs. He's only made 2 postseason appearances. In the postseason, the first game versus New Orleans, he had a lot of catches and was productive. Versus Dallas, a little bit less productive with, I think, 8 catches for 85 yards. His career was wasted. He didn't do nothing. He was productive on the field. I'm talking about team success.
Mm-hmm.
He was very productive, had great numbers, was an integral part of that offense, a guy that obviously had, you know, elite speed, was a brooding force, a nice target for Matthew Stafford, and that combination was something that was entertaining on that side of it. When you go down there, you have a chance to see Calvin Johnson do great things. He was a matchup nightmare when you'd go down there and watch him. He'd do great stuff. You could see that, okay, hey, this is a guy that can help your team win. But in the end, he played 9 seasons and only got to 2 postseasons and only had no wins, no success. And everyone that talks about it, well, why is Calvin retiring? Does it have to do with the money? Is he injured? That's all part of it. But the other part that you have to throw in the mix is the Lions organization and their lack of winning. That's, and when people say, what's the reason? There's no one reason. But when you add that all into the mix, the Lions losing, the way that the the way that playing 9 years has taken a toll on his body, the fact that he's probably already got 40, 50 million liquid cash in the bank, all that all together makes it easy for him to walk away. He doesn't, and the part that sucks is, and this is not a knock on Calvin Johnson. It's not a knock. He's not a winner. Period. Calvin Johnson's not a winner. He's not a guy that would maybe go up to the organization and say, do this and this. He doesn't stand up. He doesn't make waves. He is a model citizen, shows up to work, works out hard, leads by example, but he's not a winner.
Maybe not a leader?
He's not a winner. I'm saying I don't resign with the Lions after those first 4 years. I don't resign. He took the money. I get it. He's not a winner. I know fans want to be loyal to guys who are productive, but for me, it's not about the money. Mm-hmm. If I play a professional sport, it's about one thing and one thing only. My focus would be, what do I got to do to stand up there and get that Lombardi trophy in my hands? After that first 4 years, he should have said, it ain't going to be here. Get me out of here. Go get me somewhere. And it's not, I would never look bad upon a player. You don't have to do it publicly. You don't got to send out tweets. You don't got to do that. Send out your feelers to the organization. Get me the hell out of here. Get me to a winner.
Let me try to read between the lines here. So what you're kind of saying is, if he played on a team like New England, where they sit there and they have a lot of success and they win, he wouldn't be retiring right now?
Exactly.
Is that what you're saying?
If they just had come off of a NFC title loss or a deep run, that would put in the pros column to come back. Of course. The losing has to take a toll on you mentally. Would you show up each and every time to do this podcast if you knew zero people listen to it? Zero. All the time. And nothing would come from it. Would you keep just coming here and talking to me about sports?
I think we would have had a long discussion about what we're doing wrong.
Exactly.
We would have had a talk.
Yeah, or you would have had to come to me and say, hey, man, I have to go out and look at some of these other networks that popped up after us. What's going on with them?
We would have figured something else out.
Exactly.
I wouldn't have left you.
Oh, that's
but,
good.
But
that's
we would good. We would have figured something else out.
I might have left you. I was like, I'm hopping onto another network, man. They have listeners. But I'm saying it's about looking for a goal. It's about winning. It's about substance. And professional athletes should focus on that. I mean, he's got a ton of money. What more do you need in terms of fulfilling your career desires? He should be on a winner. And the fact of the matter is, I'm not a fan in football being a silent leader. Lead by example. And I'm sure in the locker room.
I don't like that either.
I don't like that.
I don't like that. And I think that was probably his biggest issue that I've ever had with him is that he's never come out. He's never been vocal. He's never come out and he's never said, I need this.
Yeah.
This organization needs to get me this. I don't think that makes him not a winner, like you're saying. I just think he's not a very good leader. I don't know if, and I know everybody points to, oh, he's the best player on the team. Just because you're the best player on the team doesn't always make you either A, the captain, or B, the leader of that team. Sometimes it's a guy who can motivate you to go out and win, sit there and get you focused in to where you have to go do your job. And yeah, I'm sure he leads by example. I'm sure he's there. He's catching balls after practice. I'm sure he's in the film room studying things. I'm sure he's taking care of his model. Exactly.
He's professional.
It's just,
but he's not a winner.
I'm gonna go with he's not a leader. You go not a winner. I go not a leader. And I think we're saying the same thing. We're just using different terminology.
No. Yeah, he's not. He's dead. There's no debate. He's not a leader. There's no debate. He's quiet. He's lead by example. Be professional. Do what I do. That's fine. When I say he's not a winner, I mean that he's okay with retiring, having all that money in the bank. Of course, it's going to burn his ass. He's going to be like, oh, well, I didn't win and all that. But for me, a guy that's a winner does everything humanly possible to get on a situation where you're going to win, period. And that doesn't mean staying with the Lions. I think that contract extension that he got is definitely sets up his family and things like that. But for me, if I'm playing on the Lions those first 4 years and I'm seeing what the heck's going on here, he should know that this organization would not get to the playoffs that many times in his tenure. He should know that. You think that having Martin Mayhew and LaWand, I don't know, did he agree with some of those draft picks? I would have had the foresight and said, oh man, look what they're doing here. Look what they're doing at this organization. I would have just said, okay, I send my handler up to the guys and say, I'd like to have another opportunity to go somewhere else. Play a couple seasons with Green Bay. Play a couple seasons with Carolina, Atlanta, Seattle. Teams that are competitive. Get me somewhere where I'm going to win. I take less money. Like I said, you get $10 million in the bank. You can live off that for the rest of your life if you're smart. For me, it's about getting the Lombardi Trophy. Staying in Detroit his whole time, that's nice. He got the money. Fine. He's not a winner. Period. He's not a winner, and he's a guy that I would say wasted an NFL career. But in the end, he doesn't care. I would say that he's going to walk away, do his charitable work. He's going to have a life outside of football. He wasn't ride or die, and it's not insulting. For some people, you can get content with your situation when you realize, okay, hey, I want to walk away from the game with so much money. I used football as an avenue. Look at a guy like Shane Battier used basketball as an avenue to now further his career. Other guys have used football as a way to kick off businesses and do other things. I get that. But in terms of ride or die people, the people that will reach the ultimate success are people that when the shift is over at 6 o'clock, they don't leave. They stick around till 9, 10, 11, 12, watching film, working out, doing that extra 200% that you got to do to win. And those are the people that are successful. I just don't think Calvin was in that mindset now in the last 4 years. Got his money, was happy to play football, and now he'll be happy to walk away in the limelight. You're not going to see him on the NFL Network doing a whole heck of a lot of stuff.
I think what you say has a lot of credibility, but I think once he kind of signed that extension and he signed that all those bonuses and he started getting all this money and his cap hit ballooned up to almost $25 million, I think it became hard to sit there and try to move a guy like him. I would have loved to have seen him gone to Carolina. I thought Carolina would have been a perfect fit at the trade deadline, and it really kind of
annoys
me.
But that's not on him.
Me.
That's not on him.
No, and I understand that. But what you're saying is if he would have went up to the front office and said, hey, I want to leave. Trade me.
This year,
figure
maybe, yeah.
Figure it out. Get me somewhere. Send me to Carolina. They have zero receivers. Yeah. I'll go play in the Super Bowl. Send me there. I think it becomes difficult because of his salary cap and because of where he was at, because he signed. He took all that money. And I think what you say has a lot of credibility, and I think you're kind of right on, where you're right. After the first 4 years, maybe even after the next 4 years, why?
What's the point? What's the point?
What are you doing here? I mean, why are you signing these extensions?
I guess it entered my mind because you're reading the coverage in the Super Bowl and Dave Burkett puts a tweet out. You know, they're asking, you know, DeMarcus Ware's like, what would have happened if I would have been drafted by the Lions? You know, and I hate that I read that tweet. I hate that I had to even look at that and comment on that. But you have to, with the Lions history, acknowledge that some of these guys are going, oh, when they think that, oh my God, I would have been drafted by the Lions. They're like, oh, I would not be sitting here in media day living the life at the Super Bowl. DeMarcus Ware would have been like, oh, you know, I hate that they're making that face like, oh, I would have had to play in Detroit. And so that's where the Lions organization is at
Had to play there for the first 4 or 5 years.
Yeah.
And then you can go away.
Yeah, and then you can go away.
That's what a couple guys have done.
But Calvin Johnson, like I said, is a productive professional athlete. And in that mold, I give him all kudos for his career. He gave us a lot of entertaining moments. I just want, you know, in ranking him as a winner, just wasn't all that successful, and I don't think he did as much as he could have done to be a productive person for him. Now, you could say, you could argue on the other side, he's an ultimate team guy. Well, good for you. But after a while, you have to say, okay, there's other opportunities. The Lions aren't the only NFL team out there. You can be a good team guy on a team that wins a Super Bowl. Have some fun with it.
Do you think the way that he's kind of handled this whole, I'm possibly going to retire, I might not retire, and all the research and everything that's out there on CTE, has kind of lessened this blow for Lions fans? Because it doesn't seem like it's a hot button issue. Like when Barry Sanders left, everybody was pissed. Everybody was upset. And I think still to this day, fans are still upset. And half of them are like, well, I get it because the Lions suck. And the other half was like, look, man, he totally rolled out on his team and left them high and dry.
Yep.
So the Barry Sanders situation is a very hot button issue. But with Calvin Johnson, it doesn't seem like it's as emotional.
No, because a lot of people are taking their emotion, not blaming Calvin, because he was productive.
Right.
They're taking it out on the line.
Sanders was productive, though.
Yeah, but what he did was he faxed in his, and nobody really knew. People kind of maybe had rumblings, but not a lot of people in the organization knew where he was at. Calvin Johnson.
It was the day before camp opened. Too.
Yeah, Calvin Johnson's
you
been
had nothing you could do.
Yeah, Calvin's been a model citizen. Told some players, told the coach the day after. So he's told people and has let the organization know. So it's much different, and a lot of people can't hate on Calvin when you look at his career and what he did. A lot of people feel sorry for him. They're like, oh, man, you came here, and now this just goes squarely to the Lions. You had a top-notch wide receiver.
How do you feel sorry for a millionaire? Like you said yourself, he sat there, he signed those extensions.
Yeah.
He signed those extra contracts. He could have left after the first 4 or 5 years.
You just feel bad because he lost all the time.
Yeah, I don't feel bad for any of these guys.
Exactly. You know, he signed his name on the dotted line. He's going to be happy. He's going to be newly married. And if you look at, you know, not to get too personal, but he dated a Lions employee, a Lions PR young lady. If you look at who he's dating, he went up to the public relations department, found himself a nice, beautiful woman to get married to.
Do you realize how much money he made last year?
A ton.
Yes.
Very much. Yes. A lot.
He made, seriously, without bonuses, his base salary was $12.5 million.
Yeah.
Base salary.
Woo-hoo.
On top of that, he got $3.2 million for a signing bonus, and then he got an extra optional bonus for $4 million, and then he had, like, other bonuses tacked in there. It was insane. It was insane how much money he earned last year. I don't feel bad for any of these guys.
Yeah, and exactly. Bob Quinn should be right now. He should be looking at, okay, who is the, you know, 15th best wide receiver out there on the board? Who are we looking to get in the 5th, 6th round? How are we going to shape this organization to get to the playoffs 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 years in a row? Not what's going on with Calvin Johnson, because he's a piece, but he's only one piece. Bob Quinn has the big-time job of looking at, how do I build an organization? Wide receiver is just one little bullet point on his checklist, and I don't care. I understand what Nate Burleson is doing. He's sticking up for his boy. But in the end, Calvin Johnson at 30-31, he's just a bullet point. Matt Stafford probably has a couple more bullet points higher up on the priority chain in terms of what to do. But for Bob Quinn, he's got much, much more on his plate and much more important things to worry about than Calvin Johnson. He could probably take care of Calvin in an afternoon meeting. No doubt about it.
I think you're right. This team has so many holes that they need to fill that Calvin Johnson's just kind of an afterthought at this point. Like, we need to approach offensive line, defensive line. You got to work on building some secondary depth. You got to work on building some linebacking depth. It'd probably be nice to sit there and try to figure out what you're doing with your running back stable, because you got a guy like Joik Bell who probably shouldn't be back on this team because he was less than productive last year. You got a guy like Theo Riddick who maybe is ready for a more extensive role. And you've got a guy who you just drafted who can't hold on to the damn ball to save his life. So you need to figure something out there as well. On top of that, you do have to add a couple pieces for wide receiver. But again, you can go pick those guys up. Honestly, you can get those guys. If you know what you're doing in the draft, you can get them in the 5th round. You'd be amazed. I mean, honestly, if you look at the New England Patriots, their number one wide receiver was drafted as a defensive back. He was like a 5th or a 6th round defensive back that they took. I'm probably wrong with the draft round, but whatever. He was a defensive back. He was a special teams guy. And they're like, oh, you can kind of hold on to the ball and catch it. Let's try you at wide receiver and see what happens. And now, next thing you know, Julian Edelman's a stud out there. So you can find those guys everywhere. Everywhere you can get one of those guys.
Ooh, that was a good Lions talk, man. Ooh, feels like a little bit of catharsis, a little bit of venting to talk about Calvin. And then, hey, in the end, we might be just delaying this talk for another year. He might come back if they convince him. I don't know what
a
player...
Do you want him back?
No.
Because once you start talking about it,
yeah,
you've already got a foot and a half out the door. Yeah. I think, yeah. Calvin, you got to go.
It makes no sense, because you're going to get married and then start training camp. Dude, enjoy yourself. Go spend some of that money and have a good time with it. So I agree. If you're thinking about it, just pull the trigger and take care of business. All right, let's take a quick break. We're going to come back. We're going to play a round of Jock Jams, and we're also going to preview the big game. I don't know if we're even allowed to say it on a podcast. We've said it, but I'll be official for this one time as we close out this segment. The big game talk after Jock Jams. Stay with us. Doc and Jock, episode 130, Detroit Sports Podcast Network.
Get at us, NFL. Doc and Jock here for Fanatic U. If you're looking for some sweet sports swag and you love your Detroit teams, and I mean you really love your Detroit teams, you got to check out FanaticU.com. Check out FanaticU.com. Use promo code DSP. Save 15% even off the clearance items. And get the coolest gear out there and rock your Red Wing shirt, rock your Lions shirt, rock your Piston apparel. Wear it till the wheels fall off. Michigan, Michigan State, you know what? They got it too. Check out Fanatic U. They have 6 locations all over Metro Detroit. Check them out, FanaticU.com.
Yeah, we coming now.
All right, coming back. Thank you for staying with us, not deleting this podcast episode, sticking with episode 130 on the Detroit Sports Podcast Network. Big news just came down the pike. Everyone's expecting it. So is this the gentleman at Michigan that was ranked number one in recruiting?
The number one overall recruit, Rashawn Gary, defensive tackle, has signed to Michigan. He has committed.
He has committed?
He has committed to Michigan.
All right, I'll get your live reaction. What's your live reaction? I'll take a picture.
What?
Rashawn Gary. Oh, okay, now we'll get a video of it too. Give us your live reaction of Rashawn Gary coming to Michigan on this podcast.
Woo!
You're a happy guy, huh?
I'm pumped.
You're a happy guy.
Yeah,
huh?
It's good. I have no idea if he'll sit there and he'll pan out or he'll be good at all. Who knows? But it's nice to be able to go out and be mentioned with the likes of a Clemson, an Alabama, possibly even what, like an LSU, all these big names. It's nice to be mentioned with those guys. It's nice to sit there and have a kid like that want to go to the University of Michigan.
That's awesome.
I don't know if we're necessarily back yet, and we haven't won anything, let's be honest, but it's good. You know what it does? It helps you look down the pipeline here into the future, and you can say, you know what? If everything holds as true and Jim Harbaugh keeps doing a bang-up job, they're going to be a very tough program. And that's what you want. You want to be a tough out. You don't want, and this is no offense to you or Michigan State, but you don't want a school like Michigan State come into your house and bully you. You don't want a school like Ohio State to come into your house and bully you. You don't want to turn around. You don't want to drop games to a Purdue. You don't want to sit there and you don't want to get housed by an Indiana. You know, you don't want that. You want to be able to contend with a team like Alabama. You want to be able to contend with a team like this year's Clemson team who sat there and got to the national championship. You want to be mentioned in that ilk. You want to be with those guys. And getting recruits like this, it helps set you up for that. Also, having a really good head coach helps build that momentum.
I'm happy for you. You know, Michigan, you know, has had a tough road the last half decade. So, hey, you're getting recruits now. We'll see how they get coached up, and we'll see what the competitive balance looks like next year. Because really, in the end, I'm not into it. I'm not into following what 16 and 17-year-old kids are doing.
It's weird.
It's kind of weird.
It's weird.
But, man, people are like, you know, even Sklar said that, you know, his daughter will be doing her homework and she'll ask for help, and he'll be sitting there going, who went to Michigan, who didn't? I never got into it. And we've said it on previous podcasts. In the end, 3-star, 4-star, you don't know what's in a dude's heart when he shows up to campus, when he starts getting attention.
Look,
how is he going to develop?
Honestly, if you look at probably the best running back in the NFL right now.
Your reaction's priceless, bro.
Yeah,
it's good. It's good.
Look at Le'Veon Bell. Le'Veon Bell was a 2, maybe a 3-star recruit. Ended up getting picked up by Michigan State. Only MAC schools wanted him. And now he is probably the best running back in the NFL. I'll argue with you that he's the best running back in the NFL right now. So you're right. You never know. You never know. Having a good coach who knows what he wants to do with you and wants to do with your talents, that makes all the difference in the world. And I think that's the thing that Mark D'Antonio has done the best.
Let's get into it. I got 3 questions lined up for this round of Jock Jams. You ready, baby? You ready to deliver?
Yes, let's do this.
You know, because I was pleasantly surprised with the NHL All-Star Weekend. In past games, they'd be ridiculous. Just 12, 11 games, they'd skate around, wouldn't do much. It kind of got to be a yuck fest. But they decided to make some changes. This past weekend's NHL All-Star Game festivities were very, very enjoyable to watch and really highlighted by the fact that Dylan Larkin did some amazing things. And that skills competition really showcased what we got here. And then the game, my goodness. What was your reaction to Dylan Larkin's kind of coming out party with the NHL this last weekend?
I think it's safe to say that we have a superstar in the makings here. Dylan Larkin was a stud. I mean, for one, to beat a record that has held for over 20 years, and I remember when Mike Gartner went out there and he skated that lap, I remember watching that. So for him to go out and beat that record, in beating that record, he stumbled and almost died, because if he's hitting the boards, they're scooping you up with a spatula and taking you off to the back, and you're going to go sit in the infirmary for a couple days. He stumbles coming around that turn, and he still beats the record. Stud. Absolute stud. And then during the game, it's like no moment ever gets too big for him. The guy had 3 assists. He looks like he fits in so well with these grown men who are the best at their profession. And he's a 19-year-old kid. The sky's the limit for this guy. I think it's safe to say we have a superstar in the making. And I think that it's having Jeff Blashill here really helps his development come along, because if you had Mike Babcock, I don't know if he's starting or he's on the number one line. I think he might be buried on the depth chart somewhere, maybe 3rd or 4th line. I think having Blashill here really helps him out and really helps his development. And you're kind of seeing it. I mean, the dude went to the All-Star game and he shined. He performed with studs, like the superstars in the NHL, and he's 19 years old. It's 19. Amazing.
The future's bright.
Yeah.
But now,
kid's a stud.
Tell me that goal by Connor McDavid didn't just make you go, holy shit, bro. You didn't see the goal? Let me tell you what he did. He comes back his first game versus Edmonton. My wife was even like, holy shit. He goes into the zone. There's 2 defenders on him. He stick handles through the one guy, through the guy that's in the front and in the defense. does a couple moves, dekes the goaltender out, and it was just an amazing goal. So in a chance, if we get a break, Google Connor McDavid's goal from last night. It reminded me of Wayne Gretzky. Connor McDavid, Dylan Larkin, the new wave of young talent is unbelievable, and it's just exciting to watch. So check it out. It's a really interesting goal, and I was like, oh, man, Connor McDavid came back from that collarbone injury. All right, let's switch gears, talk a little bit about the Pistons. Again, up and down, playing 500 ball. News came out that Jody Meeks, who was, you know, has been often injured, he got a big contract and hasn't really lived up to it. But the problem is when he does come back, you see the potential that he has. He's a dude that can shoot the three. He's a prototypical player that, if he's healthy, would fit an SVG system. Your thoughts on the Pistons' recent play this week and Jody Meeks' setback?
I think it's mitigated a little bit. All right, you have Brandon Jennings, who has come back, and he's playing extremely well. At certain points, he looks like he might be the best point guard on the team. I think his ability to sit there and be able to alleviate some of that help coming off the bench makes losing Jody Meeks a little bit more palpable. But it sucks because Jody Meeks can come off the bench and get hot really quick. The guy's dagger from the three-point land. And if KCP's not hitting
100%, yeah, he's not playing that
and
good.
He's cold, if he looks like he's a freaking chill chest out there, you can go to Jody Meeks, plug him in, and you're going to get some return on that investment. Having him hurt and not being able to come in and kind of alleviate some of that, Kadarius Caldwell-Pope is now playing extra minutes every single game. He's playing. I think he's like top 5 or top 10 for minutes played in the NBA right now because he's out there all the time because they don't have anybody that they can really go to sit there and fill that spot. You need Jody Meeks for that. And I think it hurts a little bit, but Brandon Jennings helps offset that. And I think they'll be okay. He just needs to get healthy. And once he gets healthy, I think he can come in and he'll fill that role.
The Pistons are playing 500 ball. People are talking, okay, hey, Reggie Jackson did show up versus Brooklyn, got that win. Are you confident that they'll fix this issue, you know, of up and down play by the playoffs? Or are we looking at a 500 team that has to just do a lot to advance in the playoffs? It's tough to see because
it's a tough question.
I feel like as we're sitting here, we know what the Pistons are. They'll be a 500 team. They're going to probably squeak in the 7th or 8th spot, and they may or may not play some good games. I feel like I'm looking at a 6-game first-round exit kind of team.
I can see that. The thing about them, because they show so much promise at certain times, you're like, well, maybe we make a trade. Maybe we go get that other piece that we need and plug them in, and maybe this team will make some noise during the playoffs. Or should you maybe wait because they do show moments where they have flashes, but then again, they have nights where they sit there and they go out and they get ran by the Cavaliers, they get ran by the Raptors, and those are like the two best teams in the East right now, so you can't contend with them yet. So maybe we wait, maybe we develop that talent, maybe we don't give up anything, maybe we keep everything we have and we try to build for the future because it's not going to happen right now. They're in a really weird spot because I feel like they could go either way, you know? They could either trade for something and possibly make them better, or you can wait and you can try to develop it and get better in a year or two when this team gels a little bit more and your natural leader kind of comes out. Because we've talked about this on previous podcasts. They don't have a leader right now. Nobody is in anybody's face demanding excellence. And I think that's a large problem. And I think that's why we have these up and down games. So,
oh, shit, Sherlock.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you.
The Pistons don't have a leader. Yeah, I know. It's tough to say, but it's been obvious. And we got to find that leader in order to help out this team. All right, cuz. Big game Sunday. Everyone's out there and they are ready to sit down this weekend, enjoy a nice, you know, gathering, whether you go out to the bar, whether you go out to a Super Bowl party. What makes a Super Bowl party great for you, and what food are you looking forward to eat? What Super Bowl treats, appetizers, food makes a great party for a game that's of this magnitude?
Well, one, I think you have to have a nice TV. Like, if you're watching this thing on your mom's old school tube TV that's in her basement, that's probably not cutting it, bro.
Tube TVs.
Right. It's probably not cutting it. But you get a nice HD flat screen that's like 60-some inches big. Yeah, I mean, crystal clear colors, great surround sound system so you can hear everything. Like you hear Peyton Manning, Omaha! Omaha! You can hear it like that. I'm in all day long, right? So I think having a good TV, having good people that you enjoy the game with and that you can have a legit conversation with about the game that's ongoing, I think that really helps and adds to the enjoyment because, honestly, man, let's think about this.
The newbies can really mess up your
night. Yes. I mean, when you're sitting there trying to explain what a first down is, mm-hmm. you're just like, well, why are you here? You're here for the nacho dip, right? Okay, right. Cool. Go sit over there. Don't talk to me. So the people, the TV, and the food, man. You got to have good grub because this is like an all-afternoon celebration of football. This is the culmination. I mean, honestly, I play in a rec league hockey, right? And we suspend games for the Super Bowl. You're playing on Mother's Day. You're playing on Father's Day. They would sit there and they played us like the week of New Year's Eve. They played us the week of. But Super Bowl rolls around. Don't worry, we got to take that day off.
Yeah.
So, like, everything stops for the Super Bowl.
Exactly. One year specifically, I remember, I had to lay the foot down because I couldn't believe what was going on. It actually snowed the night before the Super Bowl maybe 3 or 4 years ago. And so there was a good maybe 3-4 inches of snow in my driveway. And I was excited, ready to get up at like
3-4 inches in your pants?
Yeah. you bring it to a halt. I'm not thinking about that.
He just stopped. He was like, oh.
Oh, man. So I get the request from the family, like, hey, go out there and shovel the snow. It's like, and I love.
And you don't shovel snow.
No. I wanted to sit. I love getting up at 9 o'clock. They got 6 hours of pregame. You're going to know the ins and outs of all the players. You're going to know all the storylines. You're going to know when the team arrives, who's going to wear what to the game. I wanted to know all that. And I just want to be able to sit and watch the pregame. And like you said, enjoy it. I'm kind of now middle aged now. I kind of just want to be a little bit quiet. Just sit and focus. I might put my phone down and just hear the stories and soak it all in. But that day, I had to go out there and shovel and get all sweaty and dirty. I'm like, okay, forget it. Now I'm going to plan my day around the Super Bowl, really enjoy the experience, get out there and have some good food, burgers or barbecue or chicken wings, as some people would say. It doesn't matter. As long as it's grilled and it's delicious, any Super Bowl foods are great, man. I even love the, you know, weenies wrapped in phyllo dough, man. That stuff's good. Yeah. Appetizers, you just go out there, have a good time, and if you're lucky, maybe in 5 years, the Monday after will be declared a national holiday, and we can all just eat as much as we want, drink as much as we want, and waste the day on Monday. I have a kind of a light schedule coming up on Monday, so that's good. Maybe just a podcast and a couple visits, so it'll be nice. I can recover and then watch some of the post-game and watch the analysis, the celebrations. But yeah, the Super Bowl should be a holiday. I can't wait to watch it. I can't wait to talk about it, and it'll be a fun experience. And maybe we'll tease it. We'll tease where we're going to do, what we're going to do for the big game coming up after the break. Great round of Jock Jams, sir.
What makes a Super Bowl for you, man?
What makes a great Super Bowl? A great game. Great really, game. You know what?
You don't want a game like Seattle and Denver?
No, exactly.
Where you checked out after, what, 5 minutes
right,
into the
I just want a
quarter.
Competitive game. And actually now, I'm kind of curious to see what the commercials are going to look like because I don't want to be seeing no dead kids and some weird-ass themes like they had last year. I want to see nice commercials. Maybe
you do
nice...
love the commercials.
I do like the commercials because, because now, you know, we're doing this podcast and we're seeing how kind of some of the business side of this thing goes. If a company's going to spend whatever millions of dollars on a commercial, I want to go, that's what you came up with? I mean, hell, you and I debate back and forth simple logos and shit. We're yelling at each other. We're going, I hate this. You hate this. Imagine if you're going to spend $1 million. We couldn't get it out. We'd go way over deadline. We'd just go forget it.
We get nothing done because all we do is we go back and forth.
We're like, I hate this. You hate that. That's it. So I'm like, what the hell? So imagine if we had to spend to make a decision on like $5 million for 30 seconds. Be like, what? You know, some of the ads have been really disastrous. And if you flub that ad, your company's gone. Like, remember the tech days of all the e.this and .com's? All those companies are gone. And when you spend that much money, I just want to see a good commercial and one that's good. So Budweiser always does good. Doritos, the Clydesdales you always look forward to. And then you want to see some shocking things or some things that make you have some good water cooler talk.
I did just see your Connor McDavid goal.
Damn, bro.
It was a nice goal.
Those are my favorite kind of goals. Stick handling, get through the defense, and undress the goalie.
I mean, I really think what kind of makes, I don't know, watching it almost looked like it was a busted play that kind of he got by the defense there. Mm-hmm. But I think what made it so special is that it's his first game back.
Yeah.
So just got done missing 37 games. It's his first game back. So he looks like a stud coming right back. And he was
doing
pumped.
That. Woohoo. Yes, sir. Let's take a quick break. Great round of Jock Jams. We'll come back. We'll look at the big game and talk about what we expect and what we're going to do for Super Bowl 50. Stay with us, Doc and Jock, Detroit Sports Podcast Network, episode 130. I want to tell everyone out there about DetroitSportsNation.com. They're a great website, and they've been very supportive to all the shows on the Detroit Sports Podcast Network. They host all the podcasts. They have great writers that cover all the Detroit teams, all the college teams. Check out their website and support those who support us. DetroitSportsNation.com. The collaboration has been excellent, and it's helped us to continue to grow and have great guests take phone calls. So our collaboration with the Detroit Sports Nation has really been successful, and support those who support us. DetroitSportsNation.com. All right, everyone. Thank you for your support. Thanks for downloading another episode on the podcast network. Dude, this celebration for Michigan's still going on, 2 hours strong. Man, oh, man, they really did pull
no
punches.
They just got the number one recruit in the country.
Now, yeah. I think this might be the closing remark. Maybe Jim Harbaugh. We'll see.
National championship?
Yeah, hey, we'll see.
Next year? Probably not.
No,
they're trying to win a Big Ten first.
There's already been a couple who's got it better than us going on. So Jim Harbaugh's pulling out all the stops,
oh,
man.
Boy.
All right, big game, Denver. Carolina, mm-hmm. All the hype. I feel like it's been a fast 2 weeks. I feel like sometimes they drag, but there's been a lot of storylines. I think that week off was good. Well, we got a chance to look at other things. Now we're right in the middle of Super Bowl week. All the media's there. Lots of good stuff on Radio Row. Lots of great interviews. Now, the news has been relatively quiet, which is good. None of the players have been arrested yet. None of the players have done something to get kicked off the team.
Arrested yet.
Not yet. It's still Wednesday.
There was the whole prostitution sting that got a player sent home, so that's going on, but whatever.
Oh, I missed it. What happened?
I think it was Randy Murray. I think that was...
Oh, hey, now.
Yeah,
okay.
There's,
I spoke too soon.
Got busted with a prostitute, trying to solicit a prostitute, and yeah, he got,
is that
sent,
really,
home.
Is that
got
really,
sent home yesterday.
He got sent home. What team is he on? Is he on Carolina?
Denver.
Yeah. Okay. So I misspoke. Oh, okay. Look at that. Some salacious news that missed the doc's attention.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, now. This is a Super Bowl that has the potential of being a really solid game that can go to the fourth quarter back and forth, and it also has the potential to get out of hand rather quickly. A lot of people are looking at Carolina's offensive potential. They know that Cam Newton's on a roll. They know that this team is averaging 31 points a game. Top offensive team, one of the top offensive teams that played this year. Carolina has a good defense, sixth in the NFL. So they have the respect. They have a lot of people picking them.
Ryan Murphy. That's who got sent home.
And so a lot of people are on the Carolina bandwagon. I'm struggling a little bit because I'm old school. I like elite defenses. I like the fact that Peyton Manning has experience, and I like the psychological edge that could be had by Denver if Peyton Manning comes out and says, hey, this is it, maybe today or tomorrow. Secretly in a meeting, he can come out and say, hey, this is my last rodeo. I think I'm going to be done after this. That can be a huge lift for that defense to try and carry him. So it's going to be, again, a game where who's going to execute, who's going to make the mistake. Now, everyone's assuming that Cam Newton's just going to roll up in his first Super Bowl and do the dab and play great, and everything's going to be perfect for him. It can happen. But Denver this year has played more teams that are elite. They've beaten Tom Brady twice. They've beaten pro-caliber quarterbacks. They've played tough games, and that defense has withstood a lot of tests this year. So, does Denver's defense slow down Carolina? Do they make those extra couple plays? Can Peyton Manning maybe just step up that one time this year and not look and throw ducks and actually hit his receivers in stride and actually play a productive game? Or do they go with, hey, let's protect Peyton Manning, let's bog this game down, play solid on defense, run the hell out of the ball, and try to just let Peyton Manning manage this game? A lot of great storylines, a lot of great things to look at in this game, so it has the potential. But, again, rather quickly, you know, look at that game that the last time Denver was in the Super Bowl. Snapped over the head, and Seattle was like, see ya, and that was a wrap.
Exactly. So, going into this game, this Super Bowl, I think, has a huge effect on how his legacy will be viewed. Will we consider him as one of the greatest quarterbacks to ever play the position? Because he basically ran his own offense for his entire career. And he's gone into Denver, and they brought Gary Kubiak in there. And Gary Kubiak tried to change things, and he's like, look, it isn't working. Let's do a hybrid system. And he's even been able to adjust his system on the fly and allowed Peyton Manning to be Peyton Manning and allowed Gary Kubiak to kind of run his offense the way Gary Kubiak wants to run his offense. So going into the Super Bowl, if he wins, I think this helps cement his legacy as one of the greatest of all time. I don't think he is on Tom Brady's level because Brady has many more rings. And he did it a little bit different. But I think you can say that, hey, he now has two titles. He's been there a couple times. He's won it twice. He is an elite quarterback, and he was one of the greatest of all time.
Now, I want to disagree with you a little bit, but here's the point I want to make to you. I think he is a great quarterback.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if he loses, I think you still consider him great, but he's still in that class of quarterbacks that you respect and is upper echelon. But if he wins that second one, he joins the conversation of quarterbacks like Brady, like Joe Montana, like those guys that you consider to be elite. He's a great quarterback with great accolades, and he's already got the ring. So
but
he's in the conversation.
Here's the thing, though. He's a great quarterback.
He's got a ring.
In the regular season.
He's got a ring.
I get that. I understand.
Does that mean nothing?
No, it means something, but look, Tom Brady's got a lot of rings, too. I don't think he won his first one. I don't really think he won his second one. You know, down the stretch there, yeah, he's won, I think, two out of those four, and he's helped pilot that ship for four rings. But that being said, I don't think that Tom Brady is the be-all, end-all right there. You know what I'm saying? But with Peyton Manning, he won one ring. His numbers in that Super Bowl weren't the greatest, and his numbers in the playoffs aren't very good. So that being said, he's a great regular season quarterback. And I think if he loses this Super Bowl, he becomes one of those quarterbacks that are a yeah, but. Hey, Peyton Manning's a great quarterback. Yeah, but he could never win the big one. Yeah, but once it got into week 18, he struggled. Yeah, once the pressure was on him, he folded like a card table. Yeah, but Eli the mouth breather has one more ring than him and did it with a lot of different talent than Peyton ever did it with.
But then the other side would say, yeah, but he was able to get to the Super Bowl numerous times. Yeah, but there was another big team out there that was on par with some of the great NFL teams in terms of New England. And so, yeah, but he does have a Super Bowl ring.
Well,
yeah,
he'd be, but he had a great career. One for three, right?
Or one and three.
One and three. So I don't think that's very good. I mean,
no, it's not very good, but it would take the comparison that you'd be looked to is say, compared to the elite quarterbacks out there, he's at the lower end of the list, but he'd still be considered great.
So does he get elite status because he has one ring in your mind?
Does he get elite status? No, he gets,
because you just said that he'd be at the lower end of elite.
The lower end, maybe not even on the list at all.
I don't think he should be considered on the elite status at all. I mean,
let's put your
top quarterbacks in order, however you want to do it. Doesn't even have to be in this order. Let's work through this real quick. All right?
Montana Brady.
You want to throw Elway on there?
Elway.
Okay, Elway.
Terry Bradshaw,
because he won four.
Mm-hmm.
Who else do we got out there? I mean, how far back do you want to go? You want to keep it semi-recent?
Sure.
Because let's not include Bart Starr and
sure,
all that stuff. So what? We'll go, what, four then?
That's sure. That's fine.
Four. And then what? Do you go Drew Brees? Do you go Peyton Manning? Do you go Eli? Eli's got more rings than both those guys.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean,
Peyton goes on at the end of the list.
He's just
the end.
I don't know, man. Like, you have to be really, really, you have to be almost, you almost have to change the game to be considered elite.
Okay,
in my book.
Yeah. So if he gets that second win, if he gets it,
then
move him up the list.
Yes. Okay, then we can have a discussion about his where he ranks on the elite status. If he goes into this game and loses, I think he's been a very good quarterback for his career.
Yeah,
I think
but
he does
issues.
A great exactly. I think he does a great job in the regular season. But once he gets to the big game, he struggles with it. Whether it's too much study time, too much pressure, he can't throw a football to save his life in the big games. I don't know. I have no idea. I mean, it could be any number of things.
It introduces the ability to debate that he's not that great.
Right.
I agree 100%. That's why I believe that he's going to try to play his best game to go out in style. I believe that Denver's going to play a great game. I believe, when you look at it, if it's going to be a good game or a dud, I would say that's going to be a good game to the fourth quarter. Back and forth, and both teams doing their best to try to, handle each other's strengths and weaknesses and really come out with a great-looking game. So now one of the storylines is...
This is on the flip side now.
Yep.
Now we've got Cam Newton.
Cam Newton.
Who's been extremely polarizing through this entire playoff run. A race has been brought up. His celebrations have been brought up. The way he acts, the way he talks, just the way he interacts with fans. Everything has become hyper-scrutinized with him, and I don't necessarily understand it.
And I'll tell you. I'll break it down. People that are thinking it's a race thing, I think are trying to look for something that isn't there. It's not about race. It's about what we talked about at the beginning of the show. It's about, in sports, are you on the side of class and act like you've been there? Or are you on the side of, hey, show a little fun and celebrate? I don't think race has anything to do with it, because when you say, well, is Cam Newton now a great black quarterback? In the end now, Russell Wilson, Colin Kaepernick, you've had now a lineage of guys who've had success. We don't have to talk about Cam Newton being a great black quarterback. He's just a great quarterback. I think the question that people are asking and the terminology that people are kind of throwing out there is, well, why is he called a thug and things like that? And is that a new word for something that's racially derogatory? But the problem is people are bringing up some of his indiscretions that happened in college. And as a youngster, he made some mistakes. But as a quarterback, the question and debate that you have to have is really relatively simple. Are you on the fence of, hey, be professional, be upstanding, handle your business, play like Peyton Manning? Or are you on the side of maybe the new school athlete, or on the side of showing extreme passion, dancing, dabbing, having a fun out there? It's two sides. And this is why it's going to always be a polarizing debate, because people go back and forth. Sports are fun. in my opinion. You can't, you have to have that passion as a coach, as an athlete. You're playing a sport that could potentially get you killed nowadays. You score a touchdown and people think, oh yeah, it's easy. No, man, it ain't easy to score a touchdown. You go out there, you have a good time. But the problem is though, the 50% that are like, hey, if I was doing it, I'd just be suit and tie, handle my business, I'd be professional, I wouldn't do that, I'd be like Barry Sanders. You have an old school way of thinking, which I understand, and you have a new school way of thinking, which I also understand. I would lean toward probably in the bigger moments, if I scored a touchdown in the Super Bowl, hell yeah, dude, I'm doing the salsa, I'm doing flips, I'm high-fiving, I might get a penalty for excessive celebration, but more often than not, I'd score a touchdown, run around, fist pump, and go down. But in the big moments, I would display it because you have to have passion in sports. So that's the debate. The debate is professional and classy in sports or wild and rowdy, and they'll always clash. But I think it's more fun to be wild and rowdy, have some fun playing football.
I never understood how race kind of got worked into this, and I can understand with a thug terminology, I get that, and I understand where that's coming from, but I never understood why his race has anything to do with it. We've seen black quarterbacks before. We've seen great black quarterbacks before. I mean, I think Russell Wilson is one of the best in the league right now.
I think it's brought up because people are asking the question, why is this being brought up?
I don't understand it myself.
And they're answering it. They're speculating that it's because of race.
Okay. That being said, I think you're right. It's all about
it's
celebration.
Not about race.
It's all about race. It's all about how he celebrates. Mm-hmm. And I think Cam Newton's a lot of fun. I like watching Cam Newton.
So do I.
I like the way he plays the game. I like how he goes out there and he's bigger than everybody else out there, man. He looks like he is a superhero. And the way he does things, a quarterback's not supposed to play the game that way.
No.
Like, he puts his head down, he will bum rush a linebacker, and he will drag a linebacker like he's a running back. And I enjoy watching that because you're not used to seeing it. And I think the way he plays is great. I think the way he interacts with the media, I think it's a lot of fun.
He's having fun?
I was watching some of the media day last night, and one of the guys in the media sat there and they tried asking him a question about why he's a great black quarterback. And he was like, I'm just a great quarterback. Like, he diffused it right there. And the guy kept pushing and pushing and pushing. And Cam's like, look, man, you're looking for something that's not there. And then another media guy was like, well, why don't you just answer the question? He's like, there's no question to answer. I'm a great quarterback.
That's
you
it.
You know, that's it. That's it. Done. And
that's
I think
the best way to handle
yes,
it. Perfect.
Exactly. So I don't understand why people are looking for something that I don't think's there. It's like you said, either you're a fan of his celebrating or you're not. I think some of it does ride the line of excessive. But that being said, I also enjoyed watching Ocho Cinco do his thing. Yep. I mean, him changing his name from Chad Johnson to Ocho Cinco, I thought was funny. I liked watching Terrell Owens when he grabbed the popcorn and the pom-poms and he was sitting there shaking it. And I'm shaking it right now in my seat.
Yeah.
I mean, I enjoyed that stuff. I thought that was funny. I like watching J.J. Watt celebrate after he tackles a quarterback. I like watching these guys celebrate. I think it's fun.
And let's just break it down to the raw level. Look at how you reacted to when your team got a number one recruit. You were screaming, yelling, you were showing passion. Some people will sit in their high horse and just say, why would you judge recruiting? Mm-hmm. He's just a guy that, you know, we have to see how he develops. That's no fun.
Right, just a kid.
He's just a kid.
Whatever.
Why? Yeah, that's no fun. Sports are supposed to be about fun and passion. And I think that at the elite level, you can be both. If you want to be like Peyton Manning, that's fine. But how shocking would that be if Peyton Manning gets out to a big lead and he does the dab?
That'd be gravy Superman.
That'd be awesome, you know, do the Superman, have some fun with it. But I do think that, hey, that suits Peyton Manning's personality. You can't see Peyton Manning dabbing. That's right. His personality. That's Cam Newton's personality. Why are we hating on it? Because I think it creates stories. It creates some debate because the other side will say he's not supposed to do that. That football should be a little bit more classy and act like you've been there before. What do you mean act like you've been there before? You're not playing like chess. You're playing football, a passionate game. So people that don't understand sports or maybe have never felt the exhilaration of succeeding in sports maybe might have that opinion. It's easy to sit and type that if you've never been in an athletic endeavor. But when you play sports, that rush you get, and you probably get it playing rec league hockey, that rush you get when you maybe go up and down and make a great play and score a goal that maybe you didn't think you would, you want to celebrate. You're not going to sit there and just, you know, clap your hands and just do your business. Mm-hmm. You're playing sport. You have adrenaline. So people, I think, that type that and believe that have probably never experienced that rush of what it's like, you know, to have a comeback or to have an exhilarating play happen. So, and just look at it in tennis terms. Jimmy Connors, you know, at 39 years old, riled up an entire country, you know, at that U.S. Open back in 91. Why? Because he was passionate. He was fist pumping. He was doing different things. How do you think Tiger Woods came about to be different? He was out there fist pumping, having a good time, cursing to the high heavens. And then you had the establishment going, hey, now, why is this guy cursing all the time? I just think that it's a debate between class and passion in sports. And that clash will always be there because you're going to have a bunch of funny duddies who don't have no fun.
Only on Doc and Jock will you get the comparison between tennis at its highest level and professional football at its highest level.
Hey, now, that's right.
And bridge the gap.
That's right. See?
But you know what? You bring up a really good point here. You've got a guy like Peyton Manning who is very much the establishment.
Cool and calm and collected, yeah,
exactly.
And professional.
Keeps his shirt buttoned up very, very high, very a little bit more stiff, a little bit more rigid. Exactly. And then you got a
programmed
guy like Cam Newton who plays the quarterback position totally different than anything we've ever seen and is a little bit wild, a little bit loose, has a good time, looks at everything like he's fun. Do you think this game is kind of a passing of the torch? You've got what is essentially the prototypical pocket passer, and you've got possibly the new breed of mobile, large, athletic, massive quarterbacks. And not just personality-wise, because like we said, Peyton's a little bit more buttoned up and Cam Newton's a little bit more buttoned down, but just their styles of play are so contrasting that this game, I mean, there's all this talk already about this being his last rodeo with Peyton Manning. And Cam Newton's talking about how he's going to go on and how he is now the face. Peyton's already said he's going to be the face of the NFL after this game.
Okay, so I think the question you want to ask is, I think both are the two ways of going nowadays. I think these are the two stances you can take.
You can either go one or two ways.
And if you go either way, you're going to have success. And then it comes down to who's going to play the best. Because I'll just ask your personal opinion. Would you rather roll with a Peyton Manning in his prime or a Cam Newton right now the way he's playing? Which would you rather have as a GM of a team?
I would take Cam Newton right now.
You would? Yes. I would take Peyton Manning. I would just say a cerebral assassin, ultra-professional, and would be able to probably read defenses and has a ton of experience and things like that. So I'll take a guy like Peyton Manning.
I think there's about 5 seconds at every single snap where you have a chance for the play to work as scripted. I think Cam Newton has the athletic ability to be a difference maker when that play breaks down.
Do you have any concern that he's inexperienced going into the Super Bowl, his first one? You think he might be a quarterback that needs to experience a loss?
No, the thing about Cam Newton that I think is so shocking is just the way he kind of rolls with everything. Like it never seems like the moment's too big. It's something very similar with Dylan Larkin. The moment never seems too big for them. They're able to arise to that occasion. And no, I mean, if he goes out and they lose, I think it's going to be a very close loss. I don't think they're going to get blown out. There's a bigger chance for Denver to get blown out than for Carolina to get blown out.
Okay, why is it that I can't shake this whole defense wins championships, man? I like
because you're,
Denver.
You're looking at two of the best defenses in the league now. And I think they're both going to have a dramatic effect on this game.
Do you think that Denver's defense is going to be able to shut down Carolina's offense? Is it going to be a game in the 20s or 30s, or are we going to look at maybe a 17-14 kind of game? Tight or high scoring? What would you lean on?
I want to say it's going to be high scoring, but I think it's going to be high scoring because I think these defenses are going to make plays. You've got a guy like
some
Luke
defensive
Kuechly.
Scoring.
Yeah, you got a guy like Luke Kuechly who has scored a touchdown in every playoff game thus far.
Yeah.
Do you know what I'm saying?
Wow.
And you've got a defense that has helped carry this offense at times throughout this season on Denver's side. So I can see this being a high scoring game, but the defense is getting involved. And I think both offenses will turn the ball over, and I think there will be times where something happens, and that's not so much a reflection on the offenses playing poorly, but more of a reflection on how good these defenses really and truly are. I mean, both of these defenses are incredible. They both score points. You got really good secondaries on both sides of the ball. You got great linebacking corps, and they're mean and nasty up front. I mean, they're almost mirror images of each other. And I think that's going to play a big part in on the scoreboard.
You like the defenses on both sides. You like this to be an effective game. And let's get to it. Right now, at the NFL Pick'em Challenge, I got ahead again. Michael Irvin's team won.
That's right. I can't pick anything right this year. So you're leading 48-44. Super Bowl is worth 5 points.
Okay, so now
you've got to go first.
Yeah.
Because the only chance I'm going to have is I've got to go opposite of whatever you pick.
Yes, it is.
So the line is 5.
We're changing up the rules. I understand. I understand what we're doing. So
we got to make it interesting, right?
Yeah, we have to.
Because if I pick and then you just pick what I pick, there's no point of even doing this then.
Yeah.
But exactly. I've got to go totally opposite of you. So whatever it is that you pick, you get the choice.
This is actually the best way to do it. I'm up by 4, and whatever happens, happens. And I would lean on the side of that's a tough thing to kind of talk through this because I can see it going either way. I can see Denver winning it. And I could see that. But now I have to
listen. This is going to be a great Super
Bowl. I can't be a hypocrite. I can't be someone that just, you know, puts out an opinion and then waffles. So I'm a guy that's always going to take the points. I'm on the side of defenses. I think that Denver is going to have a chance to keep this game close with Carolina winning a close game, 30-27 range. So I'm going to do it. Stick with it. I can't. It's just a hunch. I don't know why I can't get the vibe of Carolina blowing Denver out. Yeah, I know they have Ted Ginn Jr. I know Carolina's rolling with Jonathan Stewart, Greg Olsen. But I believe that with the extra week, if it was 1 week, I would take Carolina in a route. But with 2 weeks of preparation, I feel like the game's going to be closer. I feel like that psychological edge with Peyton Manning potentially telling the fellas it's going to be this last game, they're going to try to play extra special. I like the fact that Denver's getting a lot of points. I like the 5.5. So give me Denver 5.5. And I'll roll with it. I'll stick with it. But I'm about 80% confident I'm okay.
I'll be honest with you. I think Carolina's going to win this. But if I had to pick, I would take Denver plus the points.
Yeah.
That being said, I need to win. So I got to go for the win here. So I'm going to take Carolina laying 5.5 points this week. Hopefully Cam Newton wins it by a touchdown for me so I can sit there and get a one-point win.
One-point win in the Pinko Chat. Yeah. That's the best way to do it, brother.
While we were at a break here, I sat down and figured out the points for... We can get a total of 100 points doing this because every week is worth 5 points.
Yep.
And right now you're at 48, so you're basically hitting 48%.
Yep.
Well, you're hitting actually a little bit more than that.
Yep.
You're over 50% right now, so if you get this win...
I would have over 50% season this year picking yep. Which is not bad.
I'm way below. Yeah. It's been so bad for me. I can't get a win to save my life.
Man, so yeah, this Sunday for me is actually up in the air. I have no plans just yet established. It could be with the family. It could be by myself. I'm not sure yet. I'm kind of keeping it open. But I'm for sure going to wake up early, 7 a.m. for sure, watch the two-hour pregame on NFL Network, get as much stories as I can.
Who wakes up at 7 a.m. on a Sunday?
Older people do.
Oh, God. I
do. So I'm going to get up early, watch, get as many reports as I can because when you have kids, too, you got to get up early because they just start running around. Right when they wake up, it's like, put on this, put on that. I want at least a couple hours of quiet, maybe watch a little soccer if it's on, and then watch the coverage of the Super Bowl. I actually really kind of like I said, roundtable discussions about the game more than the actual game itself. So we'll see what happens. We'll see what Nate Burleson says. We'll see what the crew at the NFL Network. That's my go-to place. ESPN kind of lost me, although they've kind of replaced Keyshawn now. His contract's up. He's going. They're not going to renew him, so they're going to shake it up. Maybe add a new individual. Maybe add a Peyton Manning or maybe add another individual who's retiring. His name slips my mind. But I'm fascinated with what the NFL Network does. They have a great show, and so they've got me hooked. And if I don't get a chance to watch it on the TV, it'll be on the Verizon Wireless 100% on the cell phone.
Ooh, look at you.
Hey, now.
Yeah, I don't have any plans yet. Still trying to figure out where I'm going to watch the game. I will be watching it, though, and maybe we'll be live tweeting. Who knows?
Oh, yeah, for sure. We got to tweet with the fans, have a good time with it, rank some commercials, maybe do some polls, all that fun stuff, at Detroit Podcast. You know where to go. Talking Detroit sports, big-time sports. You can always go visit us at Detroit Podcast. Get in on the fun, uncensored, unfiltered. We have a good time with it, with the polls and the banter back and forth. Thanks to DetroitSportsNation.com for hosting all the websites. Thanks to all the guests who have been strolling in here to our office, and word's getting out, and people are kind of strolling in here, man. We're taking pictures and, you know, kissing babies, as you'd say.
That's right.
Hey, man.
That's what we do.
Hey, now. So, and also, too, just want to also thank U of M diehards, the crew over there. They support us, retweet our stuff, help get our name out there. So, everyone out there, thank you for your support. Thanks for making this fun. 130 episodes down. It's been a fun project. Another fun year of football, and it's going to be fun to watch and wrap it up next week to see what the hell happened with this game. For the jock who has mended, his grill looks good after getting sticked in the face. For the jock, Adam Straczynski, I am the doc, John Macaroon. This has been 130 episodes of the Detroit Sports Podcast.
Go Wings. Oh, Rashawn Gary's coming to Michigan, bro! Okay.
Sorry, Detroit. Didn't quite work out.
And all I can say is Detroit Sports Podcast scores!
I have voices in my head. They counsel me. They understand. They talk to me. Yeah.